Hello everybody, Peter here from the Esoteric Order of Gamers, and welcome to another video. Today we're going to be looking at the new version of Warhammer Underworlds. It's called Embergard. Well, Embergard, it's Warhammer Underworlds, but not like you know it. Well, it's a lot like you know it. It's a little bit different. But this is the new set. It's sort of relaunched. They've changed a little bit, but not too much. We're going to go through what's changed in this video, and before I get started, I'll just let you know that Games Workshop sent me this stuff for free so I could show it to you. My opinions are always my own, and I don't charge for these videos. Okay, let's have a look and see what you get inside. I've built the miniatures as well. I've started painting them, and we've got a few extras to show you as well, some of the extra warbands and relic decks. Let's get into it! Now, if you don't know Warhammer Underworlds, it's a game with a small amount of miniatures and some decks of cards that plays on a board. It's pretty fast playing and it's a lot of fun. Now, the emphasis in the past was on deck building. That's how they wanted to kick it off. But I don't know if that went incredibly well for Games Workshop. I think it did pretty well, but Games Workshop players don't seem to tend to be into deck building as much as other players. I don't know if they've quite cracked that market. So the emphasis has kind of gone off that. You can deck build between two decks. The decks are called Rivals decks. And you can do a bit of deck building, but that's not really the focus. The focus is really just on a fast-playing game, and I think they summarize it by the cover blurb, which just says, miniatures, cards, combat, exclamation mark. No mucking around there, that tells you exactly what it's about. So let's have a look inside and see what you get in the set. We've got a nice, good quality box, good to see, nice and solid, and a lovely cover. I do like this cover, it's really nice. Now, this isn't exactly what you see when you open the box, of course, because I've built the miniatures and I've done all that, so I've thrown it back into the box, and everything pretty much came into this sort of sub-box that was inside, which, you know, they're really into at the moment for, you know, getting away from plastic and stuff like that. There's this kind of thing which holds all the cards in a sort of padded piece of card. There you go. So you won't need that anymore unless you want to carry it over to somebody's place or something. You've got the rules here for putting the miniatures together. Now, one thing I did with these miniatures is that I actually did snap fit them together, because you know how they say with some of these sets that they're snap fit. I've never done that before, because of course I always use glue, as you normally do. But in this case, I wanted to play it the particular evening that I got it, and I really quickly wanted to put the miniatures together. So I tried snap fitting them without glue, and it worked really well. I was actually quite surprised. They went together quickly and easily, and I hardly did any clean up of flash and bits of plastic and stuff like that, and I got them together really quickly and I was playing that evening. So that's not an idle boast. It actually does work. There's a little quick start sheet here. Not much to say. You know, most gamers are not going to bother with that. It's just a quick way to start the game. Then you've got the rule book, and I've got more positive things to say. This rule book is really nice. It is much, much better than the previous Warhammer Underworlds rule books, which I always thought were just really too verbose, and they had lots and lots of pullouts and side rules and advanced rules and basic rules, and really Warhammer Underworlds is not a complicated game. It's pretty basic, really. You each have a turn and you get to play power cards at the end of your turn, and you know, it's straightforward. And the good thing is this rule book is written in a very straightforward manner, and the rules themselves are pretty quick. That's it. You get a few clarifications and expanded rules there, and that's it. You're done. Now you got on to how to build your decks if you want to do that. And there's some primers here which I really enjoyed. This is the Warhammer and Rivals deck. Sorry, Warhammer. It is Warhammer, but the War Band and Rivals deck primers. And this gives you a few little strategy tips for the different war bands and the Rivals decks that you can get. Now, the important thing about this set, this new version, is that the Rivals decks are not keyed directly to a warband. They can be used with any warband whatsoever, which gives you a lot of flexibility, which is pretty cool. So a little bit of strategy here, which is great, especially for people like me who aren't playing this all the time. They're just jumping in and having a game, so you can refresh yourself and say, okay, that's the, you know, the meaty combat deck, and that's the tricky deck, and whatever. So I like that. And then you've got some background material, of course, the usual background fluff, a few tips on how to build and paint them, and that's it. Nice little rule book. I was impressed with that. Another change they've got is that instead of the old days when you had two boards and you could actually choose which configuration to put them in, it's a single board now. So I don't know why they changed that, but you can see it's a single board. The hexes are also smaller, so it's a little bit more cramped. But it is double-sided, as you can see, and presumably they'll be coming out with new boards. Another thing they've changed is they're only going to do this one core set for the year. So we'll be stuck with this board for a while, I imagine, unless they come out with specific new board sets or something like that. But it's a nice sort of generic board. The artwork's fine. Works well. You know, you can get away with smaller hexes. I don't think it makes any difference to the gameplay. What else have you got? Well, you've got your usual counter sheets. I've broken these up and put them in baggies, as you can see. You've got your wounds. You've got the treasure tokens in there. Turn tokens. Your very nice dice with your custom icons on them. And, of course, counters for stagger and move and charge and things like that. And then you have these decks. Now, let's have a look. That aside. So, a few reference cards, which are kind of handy. And this is different. These are the warband cards. So, instead of the individual characters on your cards having individual inspire abilities, and an inspire ability is something that you have to do to turn the card over and thus give it better abilities. So they have a single inspire action on these for the warband. This gives you a picture, of course, of the different figures in the warband, a bit of background material that identifies which ones are which. And then on the back, as I said, inspire action there, and there's a warband ability for the whole warband, and then you have these special abilities which can be used by the warband as well. So you use tokens on these to mark them off as you use them, because a lot of these are once per game and abilities and things like that. So there's one as well for Zikit's Tunnel Pack, who are the Skaven, and the other one is the Ember Watch, who are the Stormcast Eternals. Shame we're seeing Stormcast Eternals again. I must have so many generic Stormcast Eternal figures, and they all look pretty much the same to me, but, you know, that's what they started with. Nice basic one. And of course it matches the Age of Sigmar set that has just come out, the Skaven Tide one, which is Stormcast Eternals versus Skaven. So there you go. Got that. Now, in here you have your warband deck. So here for the Skaven, for example, you have the different characters. And there's that's a normal side. That's the Inspire side of the card. And then you've got your Rivals decks. And there are four Rivals decks in the set. So it gives you two that they recommend that you get started with, and then you can mix in the other two if you want to. A deck consists of objective cards, which are the yellow ones here, and the power cards, which are the red ones. And you'll immediately see there's something different. Yes, it's all miniatures artwork, which is very high quality, and you know the team from Games Workshop are very good at doing these pictures. It's a matter of taste. I personally miss illustrations. I prefer kind of illustrations, but it's nice to see the actual miniatures on it, on the cards. The only thing, of course, is that these cards are so generic, because they're generic Rivals decks, that you don't feel that sense of this is a deck for these miniatures and here are the miniatures doing the things, if you know what I mean. So it's kind of a random selection of miniatures doing relatively difficult to identify things, which are then matched with, you know, the text. So, for example, this one's Great Fortitude, so it shows a picture of a dwarf, you know. Great Speed, I guess you could say that's, you know, that's a goblin on a warg. Don't know what all this fire is about. So, you know, they're fine. It's a choice. I kind of feel like it's a choice that allows them to sort of get them out faster and easier, because photography is probably easier to do than illustration. I know I'm cynical, but I always see that there's usually always a business decision behind these decisions. I don't think anyone said, oh, wouldn't it be great to show our miniatures? They probably thought, we could do these a lot easier if we didn't have to draw all these cards, because there are so many of them. Doesn't bother me either way, I have to say. But your mileage may vary in that respect. So, as I said, various decks there you can try out with a different style. And if you look at the back of the book, the rule book, it can tell you about the different style of these decks, which is again something I thought was great. Let's have a look. So we've got the Blazing Assault deck, which promotes and rewards an aggressive, fast-paced play style. Charge abilities, attack abilities, stuff like that. Then you've got the Emberstone Sentinels, That requires fighters to hold treasure tokens, including those in enemy territory and neutral territory. So you've got to be aggressive and try and grab those treasure tokens. There's one called Pillage and Plunder, which is all about focusing on moving fighters onto feature tokens and making regular use of the Delve ability to flip them. The Delve ability allows you to flip feature tokens to treasure tokens. So risk and reward playstyle. There you go. Then you've got Countdown to Cataclysm. It's a disaster about to strike, and with a cool head, a player using this deck will avoid the worst of it and punish their enemies. It rewards a player when their fighters are slain, but only once per phase, so a player cannot afford to be too reckless. Sounds interesting. There you go. And then, of course, the two warbands, the Ember Watch, who are the Stormcast Eternals, and Zikit's Tunnel Pack. And they've got their own style as well. Ember Watch are tough, because there's only three of them. So there you go. And the Skaven functions, warband functions best if players retain a cavalier attitude to the lives of their weaker fighters, sending them into harm's way in order to inspire the rest of the warband. Really like those little strategy tips. It's nice. So there you go. That's what you get in the set. Now, of course, there are miniatures, and let's have a look at them. And surprise, I have actually got around to painting the miniatures. I actually filmed these unpainted, and then I've had time to paint them in the interim. So here we go. This is the Emberstone Sentinels. This guy is called Ardorn. And as you can see, a huge crossbow there. And, you know, I've put a decent amount of effort into this, but not a huge amount. I painted them pretty quickly because they're kind of just gaming pieces. They're not display pieces, but I'm pretty pleased with the results. It's very easy to do armor, of course. You just want to wash it with a bit of Reichland flesh shade, give it a slightly reddish tinge, and then highlight with a bit of silver. Next up, this is Yurik with a truly enormous crossbow rifle-type weapon. Pretty impressive. And the last character is Farasa, who has the double swords. Very dynamic pose. Also, always good to put a little bit of mud, I find, or a bit of dirt on the end of a cloak. This makes it look a little bit more lived in, a bit more realistic. Then we've got Zikit's Tunnel Pack, and it's led by Zikit himself, of course, or herself, who knows, with rats. And pretty impressive warpstone weapon there. Very nice little figure. Lots of bronze, I find, works well with the Skaven. Nice base there as well, isn't it? Bit of green bubbling goo. This one is called Crittertok. Strange looking thing. Got some sort of Freddy Krueger blades for fingers there and a gas mask. Now, these are a bit shiny because I use semi-gloss varnish for my figures, which makes the colours pop a little bit more, but they're slightly glossy. Just an effect I like. This one is called Niche. And then, as you can see, he's about to throw some form of grenade there. This is Ritak, and as you can see, he's riding some kind of Skaven technical monstrosity. Isn't it fantastic? Absolutely love that figure. It's very cool indeed. And you wouldn't want that barreling towards you on a battlefield, would you? Seems to be running on rails. Love these sculpted bases, by the way. They're really nice. And finally, the perfectly named Tick-Tick, who is, of course, a rat with a bomb strapped to it. And, you know, really, what more do you want? A rat with a bomb. So that's the Warhammer Underworlds core set. Definitely worth picking up if you're into this game. Now, of course, people are going to go, oh, what about all my old sets and everything? And, I feel your pain. Unfortunately, they're not sort of compatible anymore. Some of the old sets are going to be released online, or the information for them are going to be released online. Other ones are going to come in packs, which are sort of packs of the warbands associated with the style, like, you know, Order, Destruction, whatever the divisions that Warhammer have for those kind of things. So they'll have several in there. It's a shame that everything just doesn't go out online. That'd be great, but they've sort of made a distinction between older warbands and relatively newer warbands. So people are going to scream, and there'll be lots of videos, I'm sure, going, Games Workshop are destroying our old stuff. Sorry, it just happens. You know, these outrage videos do annoy me because that's how business is. You know, everything's got a product cycle, and you play it for a while, and you can still play those games. They don't implode. There isn't a self-destruct device in them. So you can go back and still play that system. If you want to go for the new system, if you want to update everything to what's happening now, yep, of course you've got to spend more money because they want more money. They'll always want more money from you. They're not giving you gifts. So, yeah, it's unfortunate, but a game has to develop, I feel, and sometimes they just have to do a clean slate and go on to a new thing. And we've had lots of sets of the original version of Warhammer Underworlds. That said, there's not huge amounts of changes here. There's the single board, and there's, as I said, there's the warband cards, these here, so a few changes, nothing revolutionary. You can still play those old sets, but they won't mix with these. They won't mix together. Talking about new warbands, let's have a look. They're obviously sending them out. Well, these are new ones. So individual packs come in, new packs like this. And here we've got Grandfather's Gardener. So a nice little Nurgle set. There it is. And these are the miniatures. So let's have a look and see what you get in one of these warband boxes. A single sprue. There we go. Well, there are only five figures here, and you can see there's not a whole lot of fiddly bits because these are kind of snapped together figures. So I would recommend you do use glue. I mean, I usually use glue. I only did it because I was in a rush. So that looked nice. I'm always a big fan of Nurgle, so that looks pretty cool. And these are, like all Nurgle figures, really cool. I do like Nurgle figures. They're always so atmospheric and creepy, and they're fun to paint as well because, you know, you don't have to be neat and clean when you're painting Nurgle, do you? No, you can just be really messy and disgusting. So that's a very nice set. Definitely, if I was picking one, I'd go for the Nurgle ones. But of course, it depends how they play as well. Finally, this disgusting flying bloated fly. One thing I should point out when I look at this, and I don't know the prices of these, but I know that the new Warhammer Underworlds set is about $130 in Australia. I don't know the New Zealand price yet. So it is pricey, I have to say, and it's certainly pricier than the old Warhammer Underworlds set. So surprise, surprise, they've taken the opportunity to up the prices again. No shocks there. So you get a little envelope here, and what's this? Here's a little book showing you how to put the miniatures together. You've got the warband cards in 50,000 different languages. This is another little bugbear of mine. I really don't like this. It's such a waste. I don't know exactly because, you know, obviously they're saving money by throwing it all together because they don't have to localize different sets for different foreign markets. The thing is, it really frustrates me to see all of these cards, pick out the English one, and that is all thrown away. Absolute wastage. Anyway, there we go. Grandfather's Gardeners. That looks like an interesting ability. You put a count around, changes depending on the round number or something like that. That's kind of interesting. And then you've got the actual cards for the miniatures themselves. Here they are. Now, of course, as you can see, there is no rival deck in here. Now, I mentioned that thing about the language because, as you can see, it's on the card itself, like that. Now, I forgot to mention this because this is in the Warhammer Underworld set as well. As you can see, there's the Stormcast Eternals that's got the same. It kind of frustrates me a little bit. I just feel it's kind of a thing that's really convenient for Games Workshop, but not convenient for me. You know what I mean? I know it's an international market and all the rest of it, but I would expect anyone in Germany, Japan, or Korea to feel exactly the same about, you know, having to have this tiny little text on their card and having to read the English version all the time. I'd be really annoyed about that too. That'd be worse because at least the English get the big one up the top. They only get 5-point type. So I just feel like Games Workshop is such a big corporation that they're constantly cutting corners to get more money. That's how big corporations work. Constant attempts to get more money and increase profits. I've had a bit of a rough day, so I'm feeling a bit grumpy. It wasn't a very pleasant morning because my the sink in my office, not the sink, the drain in my office blocked. And I had to get a plumber in. It cost an absolute fortune. And all they did was unblock it with a thing. And it didn't work at the time. And I thought I was paying for nothing. It did eventually unblock. But it was just a frustrating start to my Sunday morning when I wanted to nice, you know, relax. So Jaws of Itzel is the other one. As you can see, it's the Lizardmen dudes. Sotex Venomites. Oh, there's only four miniatures there. As you can see, it's one sprue, like so. And same story in here. There's our cards. Crowjacks. I mean, how they translate things like crowjacks to Japanese and Korean, I'll never understand. Rotak, Sokar, Sotex Venomites. There's the card. And there's the whole bunch of useless cards that I'll throw away. These guys are pretty impressive. The Jaws of Itzel. They're big, nasty looking figures. And of course, there's only a few of them, so they have to really work above their weight, or hit above their weight. What a stupid expression. I don't know what I'm talking about. But look at that. That's a beauty. Very dynamic figure. Very nice. Big lizard man figure. And this little one as well. That's a nice little atmospheric piece. So, Rivals decks. If you want to expand your options, as I said, you can deck build between a couple of different Rivals decks. You can get these. And I'm sure what you'll find in here is just a deck of cards. Here we go. They're really not using shrink wrap anymore, are they? Wow. Everything is wrapped in cardboard. There it is. Your objective cards and your power cards. This one's called Rack and Ruin. No strategy guide there, I notice, which is interesting. Do they mention strategy? There's a little bit on the back. Rack and Ruin is a mastery playstyle deck. The mines of Embergard are a dangerous place to venture. Use the environmental hazards within to damage rival fighters and earn glory. 32 cards. I shudder to think how much that is, because here a deck of cards from Games Workshop costs a lot of money, and it's only 32 cards. But there you go. If you're into Warhammer Underworlds, you want some variety in your decks. And this one is Reckless Fury. Reckless Fury is a strike playstyle deck. Charge your fighters forward and attack to defeat your rivals. Well, that sounds kind of exactly like... what was the other one? Blazing Assault. Aggressive, fast-paced, charge abilities, attack abilities. Sounds very similar. There you go. Whole lot of Warhammer Underworld stuff. Now, I will say I have played Embergard just once and really enjoyed it. I thought it was great. It was a lot easier to learn and pick up because I don't play this constantly. I just go, oh, let's play Warhammer Underworlds and give it a go. And I picked it up really quickly and it was fun and it was close, came down to a tight finish, and I really enjoyed it. So for some reason, I do feel like this has put a lease of life back into Warhammer Underworlds and I think I'll be playing it more. There was something about the old sets. I don't know why. I always found it a bit difficult to get back into, even though the rules, once you started playing, were really, really simple. It was just those rule books, I think. I think I'd flip through the rule books again and go, ah, brain overload. So I really appreciate the new rule book. And I don't think I'll ever have the time to get into the deck building aspect of it. I'll always just grab one of these rival decks and play, but that suits my play style. Other people might want to spend more time doing a bit of deck building and coming up with the ideal deck. Hope you've enjoyed that, folks. This is Warhammer Underworlds Embergard. I will see you next time, and thank you very much for watching. As usual, please subscribe if you haven't already. Check out the social medias, go to the website, do all that stuff. Happy gaming.